Hi, I'm Mi-Ai Parrish, and today we're doing Devils in the Details, where we look at some interesting behind-the-scenes things going on at ASU. And I'm with Joshua LaBaer, who is a professor and executive director of the Biodesign Institute. Thank you so much for joining us. It's a really busy time for you, and I'm glad you can help us understand the complications going on.
Right. It's a pleasure to be here.
Yeah, thank you. So already, you know, the U.S. has the most COVID cases. And as of May 1st, we have COVID-19 is the leading cause of death in the United States. Tell us a little bit more about how we can scale up testing to help us understand more.
Right, right. Well, there's a lot of elements to getting testing levels increased. Among them are first of all, availability of the reagents and equipment needed to do the testing. I think that's certainly, there are places where that's more needed. But also actually collecting the specimens is a big bottleneck. Being able to sample people, either using the nasopharyngeal swabs, or we hope more advanced forms of testing that don't require those swabs, like saliva testing, which is something that a number of groups are now experimenting with. But it, you know, oftentimes getting the samples themselves is not trivial. People have developed nice technologies, or if you will, procedures for doing drive-through testing, which does actually accelerate the collection. But we need more sites for collection. We also need to think about ways to decide whom to test, because it's straightforward to figure out that you want to test people who have symptoms or who have known exposure to people with documented cases. But after you get that crowd, and after you get the sort of clinical workers crowd, and after you get maybe the first responders crowd, who's the next group you test? And I think we need to start thinking about whom should be tested beyond those initial groups, because oftentimes it's hard to figure out for the clinical personnel who order the tests who to get them on.
Right. So
go ahead.
So how are you prioritizing that?
So it's interesting. We've been thinking a lot about this. ASU is a university without a medical school, and we have no hospitals. So we rely a lot on building partnerships. So our highest priorities, of course, are infected individuals in hospitals, or infected individuals, mm-hmm. or people with symptoms, let's say, or healthcare workers. So those are obvious, but a lot of those are getting covered already by the hospitals and the clinics themselves. So then, you know, we've also begun partnering with first responders who are forced to deal with the public, but who cannot maintain social distancing in their work and in those exposures. And so we want to make sure that they get tested and that we can follow them and make sure they're okay. We've also been focusing some testing through partnerships with critical personnel, people, for example, who work at utilities or at, you know, community organizations that, again, they often work in control rooms or they work in vehicles where they can't maintain social distancing. And we want to make sure that they stay safe so that they can continue doing what they do for the community.
Right.
I would make the case that the next community to test and that we should be thinking a lot about are people who are exposed to the public in their work. So think about grocery clerks, people who work in businesses, people who might work at restaurants, even if they're drive-up restaurants, they still have to interact with a lot of different people and may get exposed that way. And I think we should be opening up testing to that community. There are a lot of those people, and if they get regular testing, we can make sure that they stay safe.
All right. Journalists out covering, right?
Absolutely.
I mean, you have a lot of people who are unusual. You don't really even think about that they're having to be close and having
right.
to be
right.
out
and
talking to a lot of people. And we're talking about opening up in the fall, you know, so that it creates a lot of questions about who to test, when, how that's going to be, how you do the contact tracing, which I think is really interesting too. What is that?
So you know, contact tracing.
Why is that important? People keep talking about, you know, this contract
right.
contact tracing.
Right, right. So the contact tracing, to start that, let me first remind everyone to think about why we do it. So this particular virus won the trifecta for being a nasty bug. And what do I mean by that? Well, number one, we know that it's an aggressive virus that has a severe morbidity and mortality attached to it. It's probably 10 times higher mortality than the flu virus. So it's, if you get it, even though many people don't have symptoms, a significant number of people get very ill with it. Number two, the second part of the trifecta is that it spreads airborne. So it's very easy to convey from one person to another. It's highly infectious. Droplets in the air and maybe even just, you know, just vapor in the air is enough to transmit it in some cases. So the fact that it's very infectious is another problem. And then the third reason why it won the trifecta is because you are most infectious with this virus before you have symptoms. At least that's what a lot of the evidence shows. And this is where contact tracing becomes so important. People will get the virus, and if in a number of studies where they've documented primary source and then secondary infections, they can show that this infection must have been transmitted before the first person even knew that he or she was ill. So this is why we need contact tracing. We need to know who has it, and we want to find them before they've had a chance to transmit it to somebody else. That means that if someone is detected and positive, we want to go to that person and immediately ask them, whom have you been in contact with in the last few days? We want to go back with people in particular who have been under a 6-foot radius, people who've been in contact with them for more than 10 minutes. It's certainly possible, because they didn't know they were infected, that they had such contacts. And then we want to immediately call those people and get them either isolated or tested or both. That's how we can move upstream on this virus and start to identify people before they even know that they have the infection. And that can only be done by contact tracing. And in this case, contact tracing is particularly important to be done quickly. We can't wait until the next day, the day after that, to get hold of them and say, by the way, who were you in touch? By then it's too late, they're already transmitting it. So you wanna, the minute you get a positive test, call them up and say, right now, tell us, who have you been in touch with, and can we get in touch with them so that we can let them know that they may be at risk.
Right, especially as we're opening up, you know, bit by bit, which
exactly
is good to do, but yep, you need to figure out, be able to trace people quickly. How confident are you in our ability to get enough tests, and what's being done at ASU to help in that process?
So ASU, we have set up testing here, and the good news for us, our strength, we have a very good high throughput system in place. We've automated almost in the entire process from beginning to end, including collecting the samples and collecting the RNA from the samples and then actually doing the testing. So we could run in a single shift, we could easily do 1,200 samples. And probably by doubling up on our shifts, we could get to 2,400 samples a day. So we can run a lot of samples in our process. Moreover, the platform that we're using, reagent availability does not seem to be limiting for us. We've been able to get hold of the reagents.
Okay. So in like regular people terms, you have enough stuff.
We have enough stuff in-house to run the assays. Where we're more challenged at ASU is getting the samples collected, getting all the swabs. So right now we're doing NP swabs, nasopharyngeal swabs. Those are typically collected by registered nurses. These are all volunteers from our College of Nursing and Health Innovation.
So a shout out for them, by the way.
Yeah, they've done a phenomenal job.
Amazing.
And we have a team that has put into place a remarkably efficient system for drive-up testing. So that process we have to be careful of, because when people think of drive-through, they think of In-N-Out Burger, where anybody can just drive up and order a burger. This is not exactly that. This is, you know, people are making appointments online in advance. And that makes the whole process much more orderly, because people know exactly when to show up. And the whole process is orchestrated from start to finish. We have all the person's information, so we're not waiting for them to make the order. That's already in the computer. They just show their phone, which has a QR code on it. We barcode scan that and then immediately know who's there. And then they pull up, the nurse reaches through the window and takes the sample. We've got it down to where we can collect the entire process in 2.5 minutes per car. So it's very quick. We can get
close to drive through, you know.
Yeah, well, no, it's very fast.
White Castle, kind of.
Yeah, we can get 100 people a lane, I think, in a 4-hour shift.
That's amazing.
So by putting a few lanes in place, we can get a lot. But still, collecting samples is a bottleneck. And what we're hoping to move to eventually is saliva testing. In that case, someone would drive up, we hand them a tube, they pull over to a parking spot, in the privacy of their car, they spit into a tube, and then they pull up and hand us the tube. And if we could get that to work, that would be even more fantastic.
Yeah. And, you know, to really point out how complicated this has been, this is not your day job, right? You weren't doing COVID testing before, you know, drive-through COVID testing. This is a really, you've had to get scaled up really quickly and pivot from being a research biodesign institute. How do you even?
I'm an oncologist by training. So testing for a virus was not part of what I did, but I will say that my research career has always been around diagnostics. In my case, I was always interested in early detection of cancer. But, you know, we are a research facility at a university without a medical school. So we didn't have a lot of the things in place that many medical schools have, which is many medical schools already have hospitals. They have billing in place. They have, you know, patient contact computers in place. They have something called HIPAA-compliant computers. This is just, you know, computers that maintain the privacy of the individuals. So we had to set all of that up in advance, and then we had to get what's called CLIA certification that said that we were allowed to collect information and run tests on people and provide that information back for clinical use. Mm-hmm. And we had to get authorization from the FDA. So we had to get all of that up in place, and it took us about 5 weeks from start to finish to get all of that done, get the testing running, get the robots programmed and in place, get the rooms and the safety in place, because we don't want our people exposed to live virus and with the risk of them getting infected. So, and of course we had to train our teams. So there was a lot of things to do. And of course, computers too. You had to get databases to track all that information, barcoding.
So you can actually do something with it.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm just kind of dying to know, did you name any of the robots?
Yeah, they do have names for the robots, but I don't know what they are. They have creative names for our robots.
Okay, good.
Often based on a science fiction theme, I will have to admit.
Oh, I'm so relieved.
I need to find out what the robot names are, yes.
Because I really need a good laugh or two in the midst of this, right?
Yeah. Now, you have to understand that these robots don't look anthropomorphic at all.
No. But it's the idea, right? That you've got to.
I get it.
Whatever.
Yeah, no, the teams are very creative down there. They actually have a really great esprit de corps. You know, I'm so proud of them. These people volunteer to come in every day. And not only that, but go into a hot zone with a virus that no one wants to get near and you know, volunteer to get that work done. So it's an impressive group of individuals.
No, I mean, I think that's such an important thing to note too, that people are putting their lives on the line to help the rest of us.
Yep. You
know? And I mean, I think that's a huge achievement. And is that, you know, what are you most proud of in this process? There's a lot.
That the level of volunteerism is what has overwhelmed me. We started with a group of 5 or 6 of us on a phone call about 5 or 6 weeks ago. There's now over 50 people on that call every day. And when I say every day, I mean every day at 8 a.m. Mm-hmm. We're on the call. Everyone talks about what's happened in the last 24 hours. And then, you know, about 2 or 3 weeks into it, we put up a call for volunteers that we sent just to the Biodesign Institute. Within 5 hours, we had 200 people sign up. In 5 hours. By the end of the weekend, we had 500. We're now topping probably 600. People from all over. And the call for volunteers got spread throughout the university. People from everywhere have stepped up and said, how can I help? What can I do? And so we have people writing code for us. We have people testing virus for us. We have people collecting PPE for us, people making PPE for us. I mean, it's astonishing the community spirit that developed here.
They're doing this every day, right? Yeah. You know, people are taking Sunday off to go golf or whatever. Yeah. I mean, they're really in there and they understand the urgency, which, I mean, the hospitals too, they need the knowledge coming back.
Yes.
So, because that's part of the PPE issue, right? You know, I think the tenacity of this kind of work and that you and the team have been able to really keep at that. And how, I don't think this is ending anytime soon. You know, what does that look like going forward?
Well, you know, I think you're right. You know, probably if you look at the entire population of the state of Arizona, maybe 1 or 2% at most of people have been exposed to the virus. So the virus has a lot of people that it could still get to in this state. So it's going to be a while before we can back off, and it's going to take things like, you know, development of vaccines, aggressive testing. You know, the combination of testing and contact tracing, we hope we'll be able to nip any outburst of the virus quick and prevent it from spreading from those. And if we just keep shutting it down every time it has a chance to get out, I think we can, you know, start to measurably get back to work and start to do things. But we will have to be maintaining distancing until we can eventually get some herd immunity in place, presumably through vaccination and other things like that.
When do you think it will be safe for people to get? Well, they're starting to, you can tell they're twitching, right?
Well, people, I know, and I understand it. I mean, it is to the credit of the citizens of the state that Arizona has largely, I think, flattened the curve here. I think we have, you know, our hospitals still have beds. We still have ventilators, you know, and I think that is because people took it seriously and did their best. But, you know, everybody is stir crazy and it is tough. I think we, you know, if we do it carefully, I think, you know, certainly in the next month or so, we'll be able to start slowly working our way back. But I think it's going to be a while before we can put our masks away. I wear my mask whenever I'm in public, and I think most people do now. We have to maintain our distancing. We have to figure out ways to do that so that we can't spread this thing. The issue, of course, is that I think most people are aware of is that even though many people will get it and not have symptoms, they may transmit it to somebody who will have a horrible response. And so we are doing this for each other, not just for ourselves. And that's something we have to remember.
It's such a good reminder. I mean, I think maybe say that again. You reiterate it's not.
Right. I mean,
you may not be sick. They may not be sick.
Right. Right. We know 80% of people.
Because the masks are a pain, right? Like, you don't want to stick up your nose with the testing. You don't want to wear a mask. I get that it's a pain, but you're helping.
You're helping the community. And we do. We have a lot of retirees in this community. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of older folks. There are a lot of people who have comorbid illnesses, obesity, hypertension, asthma, whatever it is. And we want to protect everybody. And so preventing the spread is saving those lives.
Yeah, it really is. I really appreciate all that you and your team are doing. It's so important that you've stepped up in that way. And it's interesting to see it come to fruition in real life, you know?
It has been dramatic for all of us, for sure.
What would you like people to know? What do you want people to really hear from? You're on the ground seeing this, really living it. Like, what do you tell your neighbors? What do you tell your friends?
Well, first of all, this is real. You know, I know there are some people who still can't quite grasp it, in part because for many of us, we either haven't had symptoms or we haven't been exposed to it yet. Mm-hmm. But there are people dying in this state and across the country. We do need to prevent the spread of the virus. We do need to increase testing. We absolutely need to do aggressive contact tracing and follow up on those individuals so that we can find the folks who may have been exposed to people, even if they didn't know it. I think those are all things that we need to take home for it. But we also need to know that this is a virus like other viruses. We will be able to develop immunity. I'm confident of that. We will be able to eventually get to a place where this becomes part of our landscape, but a manageable part of our landscape. But we have to take it slowly. Let's not rush into it. Let's get it done. Let's do it right. Let's follow the data.
Really, really so glad to talk to you today and to learn more about what's going on and to say thanks too.
So many
people are stepping up and helping like you are. So thank you, Josh. And we were discussing, you are Dr. LaBaer, like doctor a couple of times over, I think. So, yeah. But Josh, thank you for all that you're doing with the Biodesign Institute and with your team. So, thank you for joining us on Devils in the Details.
Yep. Thanks. All right. Take care.
Take care.
All right. Bye-bye.